Today I want to talk about loving God. Do you know that you were created for God's pleasure? Do you know that when God created you, your very existence is to bring pleasure to God? That when He looks at you, it brings pleasure to Him. That you are the apple of His eye. That you are the reason why He came. So you can actually look at the person beside you, and you, as you look at them, just say, God loves you. And He takes pleasure in you. You know what I'm saying? Just look at them and say, God takes pleasure in you. All right? Because God finds pleasure in you and I. God looks at us and He finds pleasure in us. In response, what do we do? If we were created for God's pleasure, if we are here that you and I bring pleasure to God, then what should be our response? You know, He created you so that He can bring pleasure to Himself, but what would be our response? Now, here's what our response should be. We find that in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verse 37 to 38. And this is what the Lord said. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. When it's the first, it means it's not the second. It is the most important. And it says it's the greatest. There's nothing greater than this commandment. And that is to love Him with everything you've got. Are you hearing me this morning? All right, so there is no other thing that should go before this. Because it is the greatest and it's the first. So there's nothing that should go before that. So therefore, my first purpose, all right, our first purpose is to love God. All right? So tell the person beside you, my purpose is to love God. Yeah, that's my purpose. My purpose is to love God. That is my first purpose in life, is to love God. It's not to get married. It's not to have a great career. It's not to have a great work, a great job. It's not to be wealthy. It's not to be prosperous. It's not to be able to buy a house. My very first purpose in life, according to this scripture, is to love God. That's your first purpose, all right? So how do we do that? By worshiping Him. That's how we love God. Often we misunderstand what worship is. We think that worship are songs. We think that worship, because that's how we've been taught, we've grown up to in the church thinking that worship are, you know, fast songs and slow songs. The fast songs is the praise songs, and the slow songs are the worship songs. And we think that that's worship. Or sometimes people have thought that worship is a part of a program in the church. So this part is worship. This part is, you know, preaching, and this part is whatever. So we think that worship is just a portion of a program. And so we think that's the way it should be. And the first mention of worship, you've got to understand that the first mention of worship is in Genesis when Abraham was tested by God. If you remember in Genesis 22, you remember that time when God tested Abraham and said that he was to offer Isaac his son. And so he was going to offer his son as a sacrifice to kill him. All right. And so on that day in Genesis, we find that he told his servants, he said, Abraham said to his servants, you wait here while we go to worship the Lord. Well, you know that when he meant worship, he didn't say we're going to go up and sing some songs. He didn't have any guitar. He didn't have any instruments. When he said, we are going to go and worship, he was talking about, we're going to lay down a life for God. And that was worship. Worship is to lay down a life. And so like, if you look at in Romans 12, this is what Paul said in Romans 12, verse 1. Because of God's great mercy to us, offer yourselves as a living sacrifice to God, dedicated to His service and pleasing to Him. This is the true worship that you should offer. So this is the worship. The worship is not the songs. The worship is your life that you offer to God. You offer a living sacrifice. Why did he say living sacrifice? Because in those days, they were offering, when they gave a sacrifice to God, they kill the lamb. They offer a sacrifice. They kill the animal and offer it a sacrifice to God. And so Paul is saying, not only do we kill those animals, the best thing for the Lord is that we offer to him a living sacrifice, and that's your life and my life. That is how we love God. We offer our lives to him. And that is the true worship. And so worship then is our response to God. That is worship. Our response to God, and worship is giving back to God. That's what we're trying to do. When we're worshiping, we are offering ourselves to God. It's our response to God's love. That's why Paul says, because of his great mercy, because of how much he loved you, because of what he's done for you, the least that we can do, he says, is to offer your life as a worship to him. If you want to show you love him, it's not by words. It's not things that we could write about. It's worship is to offer your life to him. You dedicate your life to him. That will be true worship. All right? One of the teachers of the law came to Jesus, one of the Pharisees, and asked him, what is the most important commandment? And Jesus' answer was in Mark chapter 12, verse 30. He said this, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And then he added one more, and all your strength. Wow. So, we are, just so that we get it, just so that we don't miss anything, that we are to give him everything, including our strength. So if we look at that, here's what it means. God wants me to love him with my mind, which is thoughtfully, with my mind, that's attention, with my heart and soul passionately, and that is giving my affection to him, and with my strength, which is practically, or my ability. So we are to love him with our minds, that we are to love him with our thoughts, and we give our attention with our mind and soul. This is our affection. We love him passionately. It's not just, you know, half heart, but a passionate loving for God. We give him our affection, and with my strength, we give him our abilities and our practical life, our physical life. And so we look at these things, and we look at one by one, we get to have an understanding of what it means to worship God and to love God with our lives. First is this, worship is focusing my attention on God. Focus my attention on God. And that is, when we are saying that we are worshiping him with all of our mind, we're focusing our attention on God. God knows our thoughts and everything about us. Do you know that sometimes we think that maybe God doesn't know? Maybe sometimes we think, oh, God doesn't know what I'm thinking. No, God knows right now what you're thinking. You can be looking at me right now and you're hearing me, but your mind could be somewhere else. And God knows what you're thinking right now. Right now. All right? So, here's what it says. Psalm 139, verse 1 to 3. Look what it says. You know, the psalmist says, oh Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. You know when I sit down or stand up. You know my every thought when far away. You chart the path ahead of me and tell me where to stop and rest. Every moment, you know where I am. Wow. Can you imagine? That means, my brothers and sisters, God knows everything about you. He knows you more than you know yourself. And sometimes we think that we could probably escape away from God, that maybe God will not see what I'm doing. That I could just do what I want, but God will not see that. He won't see that I'm, you know, I'm not really focusing on Him right now. I'm not really thinking about Him right now. And God knows every thought. He says, the psalmist says, when I'm standing up, I'm sitting down, wherever I'm going, you know everything about me. You know what my thoughts are. And if you're worried about something, God knows you're worried about something. All right, so God knows everything. And this is about loving Him. To worship God, we must make an effort to focus on Him. Amen? This is loving Him with all of your mind. You focus on putting your attention on God. It doesn't come naturally. It's not easy. It doesn't come naturally. You know, when we wake up, we're not the most holy people in the world. Are you hearing me? Who's holy when you wake up? When you wake up, I mean, in every situation, you know, when we, you know, we are human beings, and it's not easy to be holy and to be right away focusing on God. You must make an intentional way to think about Him. You need to focus your mind to think about Him, because it doesn't come naturally. We can easily be distracted by the things that are going on around us. Are you hearing me? Have you ever been in church and your mind began to wander? You're looking at me and you're smiling at me and you're thinking, what am I going to eat later? I wonder if I lock the door. I wonder if the oven is on, or I wonder if the kids are coming home. You know, you could be looking at me and you could be thinking of something else. You'd easily be distracted. How many times have you tried to pray and all of a sudden you're thinking about food? And you know, it's like, it's so hard. We get distracted with so many things. And you could even be thinking right now, when is He going to stop talking? We just got to finish. It's ministry launch, you know. Just get over it and let's have some food. And, you know, so our attention, we get distracted. And so we need to focus on Him. And sometimes our worries of life, sometimes, you know, you may have bills and you may have some things, and Monday, tomorrow, you know, maybe somebody's going to be calling you, or maybe, you know, you have a job situation and you're thinking about these things and you could be worried. And so we need to focus on Him. And if we love Him, we need to make an intentional a purpose to actually focus on God. To be able to say, Lord, I'm going to focus my mind on You. And do you know that's when you get peace? When you focus your mind on the Lord? Here's what the Bible says. It says, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in You, whose thoughts are fixed on You. Wow. You know, peace doesn't come by just, you know, going around and maybe having a party, and maybe, you know, people think that they will just drink their way out of their problems, and maybe they could abuse themselves, their bodies with substances that will get their mind off their problems. But you know what will really give you peace is when your mind is focused on Him. That's will give you perfect peace, because only the Lord can give you peace. Amen? He's the Prince of Peace. And so, let our mind focus on God. Let's give our attention to Him. One of the things that can distract us, you know what's one of those things that will distract us from focusing on God, is to focus on ourselves. The more you think about yourself, the more you think less of God. Here's what it says in Romans 8:7. The Message says it this way. Focusing on yourself is the opposite of focusing on God. Anyone completely absorbed in self ignores God and ends up thinking more about self than God. You see, so when we think about ourselves, we don't focus on God. But the more we focus on God, we think less of ourselves. Amen? That's the way it works. Because you cannot put your mind in two things at the same time. You're either focused on this or you're focused on something else. So you cannot have two things in your mind. So the more you think about God, the less you think about yourself. But the more you think about you, your problem, your life, your career, your job, your health, and the more you think about that, the less you think about God. And so the Bible tells us that we need to be intentional, that your very first purpose in life is to love God with all your mind. And that we are to put our our attention to Him, that we have to consciously decide in our life to say, God, I want to focus myself on You. Sometimes we can go through religious motions without thinking. We could come in and out of the worship celebrations. We could come here on a Sunday and go out, but never actually focus on God. And that's the reason why I believe that many people are not transformed, because they are not thinking about God. They're thinking about, you know, just coming and going through the motions of being able to go to church. But nothing has changed. I lived that life for many years when I was growing up, when I didn't know the Lord. I went to church every Sunday because my parents brought me. And even when I grew up, I started continuing what my parents told me. And I went to church in and out. But I was never transformed. Why? Because I went through the motions, but I never focused on God. I never focused about changing my life and following God and putting my attention on God. And therefore, my life was never transformed. And so it's so important that our very first purpose is to love God with our mind. Amen? The second one, worship, is expressing my love to God. It's expressing my love to God. That's what worship is. And that is affection. And that is, you know, having our heart and a soul to passionately be in love for Him. When we were worship God, we're expressing our love for God. We tell Him we love Him. This is loving God with all of your heart and soul. When you say you love God, when you come in the worship and you begin to love God and you just say, God, I love You. That's the reason why I'm here. I love You with all my heart and all my soul. It's not wrong to express your love. Are you hearing me today? You know, as your spiritual parent, I need to tell you, brothers and sisters, it's not wrong to show your affection to love God. You know, God loved us. He demonstrated His love for us. You know, the Bible says that Christ loved us, that He demonstrated His love for us, that while we were still sinners, He died for us. He showed His love. That's how much He loved us. He didn't just think about us. He demonstrated it. He expressed His love. And He showed His affection. And you know something? Sometimes we have a problem doing that because we ourselves, we don't know how to show affection. Sometimes we have a problem showing affection just with other people. How much more with someone you cannot see? Are you hearing me? You know, sometimes we don't see it. Maybe it's because of our personality that sometimes we don't know how to express our affection. You know, it's so important that we need to learn that affection is good. God gave you affection. God gave you a heart and a soul that you can love. And you can show your affection. It's not wrong to show your affection. I keep telling my children when they were growing up, and they know about this, that every time I tell them, it's not wrong to show your affection. But what's happened is our world has twisted that. And they showed it to be wrong because they've twisted and corrupted it in the wrong way about sex and sensuality. And they have corrupted that showing of affection. And so people have shied away and they don't want to show affection anymore. Just to think that maybe if I show affection, I'll be unholy. Or maybe it's just not cool. But you know what? Affection is good. When you show and you tell someone, I love you. There's nothing wrong with that. In our culture today, we need to gain that back. The devil has taken that and people don't know how to say we love each other. We can easily say, I hate you. But we can't say, I love you. Are you hearing me? So we have a problem sometimes of showing affection. And that's why it's very difficult to even show our affection to love God. Because we can't even show it to someone. What we can see, that we can appreciate, how much more someone we don't see. And so it's very difficult for us. And I want you to know today, and I release you to be free to love God. To be free to show your affection. To show that you are a human being that God has created. And God finds pleasure in seeing us worship Him when we love Him back. You know, let me tell you, my brothers and sisters. When you understand what is loving God and worshiping Him and showing your affection to Him, you know what will happen to you? It will revolutionize your life. The more you understand this, the more you mature in this, you will probably never be late for worship again. Are you hearing me? You will never be anymore. You know why? Because you understand it already. When you see it, it's just, I gotta come whenever I want, when I feel like it, when it's convenient for me. Because we don't really understand it. But the more you understand what we're doing when we come together, when we're worshiping Him, when we're loving on Him, when we understand that, we don't want to be late anymore. So the more mature you are, all right, the more you understand this. So it's not how long you've been a Christian, it's how much you understand what it means to worship and love God. Because the more you think about yourself, which is, I need my break, I need my this, the more you'll do that, you will be able to now break the bad habit. You know what I'm saying? I'm not talking about the emergency that you are not able to come to worship the Lord. I'm talking about the bad habit of being late for worship. It's a bad habit. Oh boy, you're looking at me. Are you still mad? Are you mad at me or... Right, it's a bad habit. And when you understand it, you will break that bad habit because you know it's just worshiping God. It's not about the pastor. It's not about the worship team. It's not about my leader. It's because God has given me His love. He died for me. He did all of this for me. The least I could do is get up out of my bed and come and worship Him. That's the least I could do. He's given you strength. He's given you abilities. He's given you 7 days. Amen? And the least we can do is to love Him and show our appreciation for Him. Amen. One day when Jesus was in a home, a woman with very expensive perfume poured it on His head and wiped His feet and with her hair. And people were upset. You know, people were going to say, well, why are you doing that? What, you know, that's a very expensive perfume. You could sell this thing and you could have wages for 1 year. But you know what Jesus said? Jesus said, why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. Because she expressed her love for God. It's a beautiful thing. God delights in that. It's the least we can do for God who loves us. You know what it says in 1 John 4:19? It says this, we love Him because He first loved us. The only reason we can love Him is because He first loved us. He loved us. He gave His Son for us. What kind of love that He's done? While we were still sinners, He just died for us. He loved us so much. Some of us have a hard time expressing that love for God. But you know, my brothers and sisters, today you could break from that and begin to understand my very first purpose in life is to worship and to love God in my life. And therefore, no matter what happens around me, I want to make sure that I could show and express to my God, who loved me so much, that I also love Him back. Amen? All right. We need to learn to say, I love you, God. You know what He says in Hosea 6:6? He said to the people, He said, I don't want your sacrifices. I want your love. I don't want your offerings. I want you to know me. See, because we can go through the motion of sacrifices. I mean, if we drag our feet, you could come on time. But then if you're dragging your feet, oh, Pastor, see, I'm here now. Yeah. I check my attendance already. And you drag your feet as if God has not been good to you all week. So we drag our feet for that 2 hours. But we could spend all week for ourselves. But these 2 hours, I got to drag my feet to come. He says, I don't want your sacrifices. I don't want those offerings that you're saying. I want you to know me. And I want you to love me. You know, can you imagine if you have a spouse, your husband and your wife, that came home and said, see, I'm here now. Because I love you. How would you feel? You know, I'll do this for you. I'll do this because I love you. But their heart is not there. They're just sacrifices, but their heart not there. You wouldn't like that too. But imagine it breaks God's heart when we do it out of obligation. And because somebody said we have to do that, that means we still don't understand what God has done for us. When we came to know the Lord Jesus Christ, it should be, God, I understand now what you've done for me. And now I'm growing as a son in the house. I'm maturing. I want to break the habit of those things that pull me down in some things in my life. I want to be able to show you that I love you because you love me first. Amen? All right, the third thing is this. Worship is using my abilities for God. That's not only do we focus our attention on God or express our affection on Him, but we also worship Him by giving our abilities for God. This is loving Him with all of our strength. We have talents, we have skills that God has given us. We don't use it only to work for ourselves. We use them for God because of our abilities. How else can we say, I love you with all my strength? How else can we show that we love God with our strength? It's through our abilities, the talents that He's given us. The practical ways that we can show we love God. God has given us talents. If you can sing, sing for God. If you can dance, dance for God. If you can do a website, do a website for God. If you can do graphic arts, do those things. Social media, administration, accounting, all of the wonderful giftings that God has given us is not only to earn an income. It is the means. It is not the end. The means to be able to provide for yourself while you're serving God. But what God wants is to offer everything that we have for Him. You know that the world can be so good at advertising all the products that they have? Wonderful. And you know the people that are behind them are Christians doing those jobs. Christians doing all of these nice things for the world. But when it comes to the kingdom of God, is we are lagging behind. We can't even come up with a beautiful flyer. Why? Because the Christians are busy doing it for the world. Are you hearing me? This is sonship. This is church. This is about worshiping God. This is loving God. So what I'm going to challenge you today, offer your practical things for God. I'm not saying leave your job. I'm simply saying, look, this is what God is blessing you with. You got this job. He's giving you talents. He's giving you skills. He's giving you wisdom so you can be performing very well in your workplace. You reflect God in the workplace. Praise the Lord for that. But then there is the kingdom of God that it needs to be advancing. We need to be in social media. We need to be in the websites. We need to be in the world out there where people will see who the church is and who is Jesus. And we need to represent Him well. Amen? If we can show beautiful products of some kind to the world, how much more we can tell them about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? The owner of the universe, the one who can heal you, the one who can deliver you, the one who can provide for you. Amen. So Colossians 3:23 says this, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. As though you were working for the Lord and not for people. See, whatever you're doing, I don't know what you're doing, but whatever you are doing, work at it as if you're working for the Lord. Meaning you gotta have excellence. You gotta reflect God in whatever you do. So then when they see you, they know that you are a child of God. You're a son in the marketplace. Amen? Because of your excellence. They wanna ask you, what is it that's in you that you can do these things? What's it about you that you can still have the joy in your heart in the midst of all the stress? And all of this is still, you have the joy and you're calm. Why? Because you have the Lord. You still have peace in the midst of your work environment. Why? Because whatever you're doing it for the Lord and not for people. And so I challenge you. In Romans 12, we'll read it again in the Message. Here's what the Message, the version says in Romans 12:1. Take your everyday life, every ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Whatever you do, everything. So friends, as I close this morning, I want us to challenge ourselves about how do we love God? Well, the Bible says us how. If we're to love God, we love Him with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, with all of our strength. We give Him our attention, we give Him our affection, and we give Him our abilities because He loved us first. You are pleasure to Him. He created you and I for the purpose of giving pleasure to Him. Are we giving pleasure to Him? Can we say to ourselves, God, my life is giving pleasure to You? Can we say in our lives, in the way we've lived our life, in the way we've worshipped Him, in the way we've loved Him, can we say to ourselves, God, I am actually bringing pleasure to You? Are we doing that, or are we giving a headache to God? Are we breaking His heart, or are we giving pleasure to Him? Because the Bible says that we are to love Him with everything that we've got. Amen? If that's not what we're doing, then we need to go before the Lord and say, God, forgive me. But from this time forward, I want to be Your son. And I want to walk in Your ways. And I want to bring pleasure to You. Look what it says in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 9. So we make it our goal to please Him. Amen? What is your goal? To please Him. Whatever you're doing in life, your goal is not to be the richest man in the world. Your goal is not to have the best wife, husband, not the best house and not best car and best possessions in life. Your goal is to please Him if you're a child of God. Amen? As sons of God, our very goal in life is to please Him. And we please Him by loving Him with everything we've got. Amen?